Ready? So I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this. One of the things that I mentioned at the beginning is that the Center for Teaching and Learning in Indianapolis created a program called Jumpstart. And the idea behind this is that there was a university, at that time the executive vice chancellor for the university very much wanted more online courses to be made available. And he wanted to figure out a way to do this in an efficient way and to create high quality courses. And so we created a program called Jumpstart. And it's just like the name implies. It's to give faculty a jump start in getting started to create an online course from start to finish. And so how this works, at least how it started, and it's evolving, and it's much more online now than it once was, when it was more like a whole week where faculty would come together every day to really talk about different elements of creating online courses. We've since evolved into much more of this is now done in an online format, but the goals and objectives behind what we try to do are the same. So how this works is that faculty are given a variety of information, either it used to be face-to-face, now it's more online, but they're also part of a community of people who are going through this process together. We're still doing something a little bit more like this. Fertiba is doing some variations on this. We're still doing this in Bloomington, where we bring the faculty together. They're very engaged. They're working together, usually over the summer. What we found is that faculty are much better off committing to develop a course over the summer than they are during the long terms, because they're busy. And during the long semesters, a lot of things get in the way, and those courses took a long, long time to actually get done. If you say to a faculty member, we're going to support you through the summer, and we're going to give you a team of people from the teaching center to support you, those courses got done a lot faster. So the team is made up of an instructional design consultant, an instructional technology consultant, and a subject matter librarian. So depending on what kind of course it was, the library person was critical, because they can find stuff that the rest of us can't find. And so they're very, very important in the process. The instructional designer works with the faculty members to write objectives, help them design the course, come up with assessment strategies, help chunk the course content. More of this, I'm going over this fast because you're going to watch a podcast. And these are the folks who are shepherding two documents that you picked up. It's the instructional designers who have come to be known as polite nags. They're nagging the faculty, but they're doing it in a really nice way to make sure that the faculty members are sticking with the schedule that they've agreed to. Because once you fall behind, you can't catch up. And then the course doesn't get done. And so to be a little bit of a task-focused approach is really helpful. The instructional technology consultant deals with all things technology, and the subject matter librarian helps to get the materials that are relevant to the content of the course. Okay. Okay. So as I said, they've moved more towards an online scenario now for helping to teach the faculty how to teach online. And so it sort of made sense, right? Why would you bring people together and put them in a room for 5 days face-to-face when they're actually supposed to be learning how to create an online course? So the idea was to do more of this online and to use the face-to-face time for when they really did need to consult with people in the center and to do less of the intensive workshops face-to-face. So there's a whole bunch of modules and lots of content that, by the way, we share. All of this content is shareable, and all of this content is available to people who want to use it, including you. So there's just vast amounts of information about what we do to support online learning.
So with this, what site is this? Just Encore
site? This is an Encore site, and it's a practice site. Actually, it is a practice course site because it has tested survey. So let me go to the next module here, because I'm going to play a couple of podcasts. For those of you who were here yesterday, some of this is going to sound familiar. There's two short podcasts that that walk you through two different pieces in the process of creating an online course. And so rather than me try to say it as well as they do, I'm going to play this podcast for you.
I suppose you said yes.
What am I agreeing to do?
Yes.
Yes.
You will go to jail.
Welcome to the Introduction to Online Course Design presentation prepared by Terry Tarr and Debbie Runchy for the 2009 Jumpstart program. In this presentation, you will learn about different methods to approach course design, become familiar with best practices related to online teaching and learning, and start to become familiar with some of the guidelines and templates we've developed in the Jumpstart program to facilitate your progress through the course design process. Although you may have the same learning outcomes for an online course as you do for the same course taught face-to-face, you may need to structure your course differently to get students to achieve the same outcomes. Imagine that you're asked to teach a new course you've never taught before. How would you approach designing the course? When you are designing an online course for the first time, you may have even more questions, such as the ones you see here. And here's the big one. Where do I start? You'll be learning more about course goals and objectives in a later presentation, but I want to emphasize how important it is to think about and articulate your goals for students and the course early in the course design process. If you are clear on your goals, that will help you keep on track as you make decisions about how to design your course. If you remember only one thing from this presentation, this is what I'd like you to remember, the IDD triangle. The foundation of sound course design is having alignment between objectives, student assessment, and instructional activities. When there isn't alignment between the three corners of the triangle, problems are likely to occur in the class. For example, students don't do well when there's a discrepancy between how they are assessed and the instructional strategies and activities that they've been engaged in. You'll be hearing more about the IDD triangle and seeing it in different contexts throughout Jumpstart. There's more than one way to approach designing a course. We're going to look briefly at three different approaches. You'll notice both differences and commonalities among them. Each looks at the process from a different perspective, so you may find elements of each of them useful in some way. The first model that we're going to look at is called Finck's Integrated Course Design. The graphic on the slide identifies the model's components. It shows that to design any form of instruction according to this model, the instructor needs to first identify important situational factors. This includes the specific context of the teaching and learning situation, such as the number of students, expectations for the course by the university, department, and profession, the nature of the subject, whether it's, for example, theoretical versus practical, characteristics of the learners, characteristics of the instructor, and other factors such as this. This information should be used to make three key sets of decisions. What do I want students to learn, the learning goals? How will students and the instructor know if these goals are being accomplished, the feedback and assessment? What will the teacher and students need to do in order for students to achieve the learning goals? That's the teaching and learning activities. And make certain that these three key components are integrated, that is, that they support and reinforce each other. This should look and sound familiar to you. It's basically the IDD triangle with the situational factors added in at the bottom of the triangle. To learn more about this approach, click on Finck's Integrated Course Design at the top of the slide, and you'll be taken to a University of Oklahoma website. On that page, there's a link to a document called Self-Directed Guide to Designing Courses for Significant Learning, which is a 33-page guide with more details about this approach. Finck also has a 2003 book that provides a full description of the integrated approach to designing college courses. if the 33-page guide isn't enough for you. By the way, all the links in this presentation are listed in the corresponding module in the Jumpstart OnCourse project site. So if you have trouble accessing them from this presentation or want to look at them again later, they'll be easy to get to. The next model we'll look at is the ADDIE design approach. ADDIE is an umbrella term used to describe a systematic approach to instructional development. The ADDIE process is considered to be sequential, so you go through step 1, step 2, step 3, step 4, step 5, but also iterative, so you go back and revisit earlier stages in the process. So the first phase in the process is called analyze. And at this point in the process, you're asking questions such as, who is the audience? What do they need to learn? What are the delivery options? What constraints exist, such as situational factors like budget, personnel, technology, learner skills and differences, the timeline you have for development, and what will students do to determine competency, and what are the classroom web learning differences, and what are online pedagogical considerations. The next phase is called design, and at this point, you determine instructional strategies that you're going to use to support the intended learning outcomes. So you're thinking about instructional activities you might use, how are you going to present content, and what other things are you going to have students engage in. You're also looking at and thinking about how are you going to graphically design the course, what will it look like? And you're considering the organization and structure of the course. How will you chunk and sequence material? And this is also the time when you create a prototype by taking a small segment of the course and developing exactly what that will look like. And then you use that for a model to develop the rest of the course. The third stage in this process is called development. And this is where you're actually creating the course. You're developing storyboards, you're creating or acquiring content, putting together presentations, actually making the learning activities, putting those together, and you might also be doing some testing and debugging of your site that you're creating. The fourth phase is called implementation, and that's when you actually teach the course. And the fifth phase is called evaluation, or evaluate. And hopefully there's some formative evaluation going on during each earlier stage of the process, but this is where you do some more formative evaluation, you do some summative evaluation of what you've created so far and how well it's working. To learn more about the ADDIE approach, click on ADDIE in the slide title to go to an Idaho State University School of Education site. Chapter 3 in Waterhouse describes the VPO-DDA, or VPADA, course instruction cycle, which is similar to the ADDIE approach. The first three phases of the VPADA cycle correspond to the analyze phase of the ADDIE model. And you can see the VPADA model is shown in the top graphic, and the ADDIE model is shown below. And each model is color-coded to see which stages correspond to the stages in the other model. In the vision phase of the VPADA model, you develop an overview of the course you will teach, considering the existing course description, subject matter, and goals of the course. In the profile phase, you gather information about the course you will create. This is similar to Fink's situational factors, such as how many students will be in the course, what level of students, how many hours of instruction, etc. In the objectives phase, you develop learning outcomes for the course. The design phase is when you consider the learning activities you want students to engage in, the resources they will use, and how they will be assessed. You will also decide in the course organization how topics will be chunked and sequenced. The development phase occurs as you create assignments, lectures, tests, and so forth that you conceived of during the design phase. The delivery phase corresponds to the implement phase of the ADDIE model. This is when you are teaching the course. You will be getting feedback about how the course is working and making refinements. The last phase is the assessment phase. This corresponds to the evaluate phase in the ADDIE model. We aren't going to get into a discussion about the different definitions of assessment and evaluation at this point, but you will learn more about that during a later module that talks about evaluating your online course. This phase involves getting feedback about student performance, instructor performance, and the effectiveness of the course. This model is depicted as a cycle to show that there is a continuous refinement process in regard to the course. The three models I just described focus on the process involved in planning a course. And you probably noticed a great deal of common ground in how they suggest to go about designing a course. Another consideration, besides the process, is being aware of what kinds of teaching and learning activities are most likely to improve learning outcomes. Arthur Chickering and Zelda Gamson summarized decades of educational research findings to identify 7 practices that most often lead to successful student learning. Although they first wrote about these back in the 1980s, the practices still hold up today, both in face-to-face courses and in online courses. So you will want to incorporate as many of these principles in your course as you can. Chickering and Gamson believe that each practice can stand alone, on its own, but when all are present, their effects multiply. If you're not familiar with these practices or would like to read the original 1987 Chickering and Gamson article, click on the slide title. You'll read about Chickering and Gamson in Chapter 2 of the Waterhouse book also. Figure 2.1 on page 32 of the book gives examples of how each principle can be applied in an online setting. For a more in-depth look at some of the ways you can use technology to apply Chickering and Gamson's effective principles, the TLT group has developed resources to help educators use technology to implement those principles. These are especially helpful when thinking about how to design online courses. For example, communication tools such as email, discussion forums, chat, and web conferencing can increase and strengthen student-faculty contact by fostering more thoughtful responses, encouraging shy students to participate, providing more communication opportunities for commuter and part-time students, and offering more time to read and formulate responses for English as a second language students. The first link on this slide goes to an article that describes how to use technology to advance each of the 7 principles. The second will take you to a library of specific teaching ideas for each of the principles that will give you many examples of how you might apply the principles in your course. Take a quick look at them now to get an idea of the kinds of activities they suggest. And keep these websites in mind to refer to as you try to develop your own course. In the Jumpstart program, we have developed guidelines for how your course is designed. We've developed these guidelines from a variety of sources, including Chickering and Gamson's 7 Principles of Good Practice, the Quality Matters Standard, a rubric developed by Chico State, and other research reported in the literature. The guidelines focus on elements, practices, and types of activities that are recommended to be part of your course. They include items such as elements that should be part of an introductory model, parts of the syllabus, course navigation, use of technology, learning objectives, and more. The guidelines will help you identify important aspects of your course to think about during the design process. The slide lists the major categories addressed in the guidelines. If you click on the slide's title, you can see the complete guidelines. We have created them in a checklist format, so as you plan and develop your course, you can check off those elements you address in your course. You aren't expected to apply every single one of them. Take a look at the guidelines now to learn more about them and to start thinking about how you could apply them in your course. We have also developed a couple of templates to help you construct your course design. The focus of the Jumpstart Course Planner is on the analyze and design parts of the course design cycle. Click on Jumpstart Course Planner to see the actual document. You'll see these aspects of your course design plan addressed in the document. What are the overall goals and objectives for your course? How will you be presenting content? What types of activities will best support your learning objectives? What types of approaches will you use to assess learning? How will you chunk your course into modules? How will you structure each module? How will you evaluate your course? This is the time for you to begin the cycle for your own course. Begin with the first phase of the ADDIE cycle, analyze, for the first 3 phases of the FPATA model, to develop your vision for the course, to consider situational factors, and to develop learning outcomes. In this document, you can start filling in the learning outcomes cell. As you proceed through Jumpstart orientation phase, you'll be expected to complete the rest of the document. The Jumpstart module planner is designed to help you think through the design of your prototype module, or any module for that matter. What are your objectives for the module? How will you know if students achieve those objectives? What instructional materials and activities will you use to help students achieve those objectives? Click on the Jumpstart Module Planner to see the actual planner. This presentation was designed to give you an overview of the course planning process, familiarize you with good practices to incorporate into your course, and to introduce you to the Jumpstart Course Design and Development Guidelines, the Jumpstart Course Planner, and the Jumpstart Module Planner. Be sure to view the presentation on course goals and objectives to learn more specifics about how to proceed from here in planning your course.
So that's an example of one of the early ones that deals with kind of getting into the nuts and bolts of actually creating an online course. And, you know, we spent a fair amount of time thinking about, you know, what research should we be drawing on to really put this program together. So when Terry Tarr was talking about the different models that were influenced, we felt that this was important so that faculty understood that this wasn't just our ideas. These were ideas that were in the literature and that were supported by research. So we very deliberately took a research-based approach in developing these courses. And so that's why Terry goes into some detail on why it is that we approach the task in the way that we do. The fact that it's online, for some faculty, maybe they skipped parts of this. But in the end, this is a pretty complete module that kind of gets people started in thinking about how to create an online course. And so actually these documents are linked to this Adobe Presenter file. And so what you have in front of you, here's how this would work then, is that a faculty member would come in and they'd say, I want to create a course on microeconomics. And I want to move this, I've been teaching it face-to-face and I want to create an online course. And so they would establish a team. I would have a technology person, an instructional designer, and then someone who was familiar with literature in that area, so some type of librarian. And so they would begin the process by sitting down and thinking through the learning outcomes. What would you like to do? What are the learning outcomes? So if you look at the course planner document, this is a document where the instructional designer sits down and says, what goals do you have for your students? That they should attain as a result of completing your course. This is what we do no matter what kind of course it is. We want to know what the learning outcomes are. Measurable objectives, we talked about that yesterday. Writing good objectives, that's the same in online courses. It would be in a face-to-face course. And then thinking through how the content should be structured. What kinds of materials will you use? What kinds of technologies will you need? And so forth. Now, here's an interesting thing about what most faculty think. Most faculty organize, actually maybe not most, many faculty organize their syllabus around a textbook that has chapters. So their first thought when creating an online course is that, oh, well, there's 15 chapters, so there'll be 15 modules. And they'll have the same name as the textbook. That may or may not make sense in an online course. In most cases, there are a different number of modules than there are textbook chapters. So it doesn't necessarily map well to say that modules should be organized around the textbook. The example I gave you of my colleague who's afraid of technology, guess how she structured the course? By chapter. Yeah. It didn't make sense to do it that way, but that was sort of, if you're really thinking face to face, and that's the way you want to organize the class, then chapters make sense. And when you've got a physical book and the students are reading one chapter at a time, that's how many of us structure our content. It might be that that isn't the best way to structure an online course. And in fact, you may want to pull content from different parts of the book and have the students be reading pieces where there's general themes or ideas or strands that move through the particular course. So we encourage faculty to step back, look at their objectives, and then say, what kinds of modules will support those learning outcomes? And it might mean that they don't use the whole textbook. Most of us feel bad that we made the students buy the textbook, so we feel like we should assign the whole book. Maybe we don't have to do that. Maybe we only need some of the textbook. For this particular course, and maybe we can go get that content open source. And I'm going to show you a couple of sites where you can go get open source content
that you can actually put into your course and use and simply attribute it to the persons who wrote it without needing to do it yourself. So stepping back and thinking about this whole process, what are you trying to accomplish? And then how might you chunk the content in ways that make sense? And so chunks of content are meaningful pieces of content that may be short or longer, but are based around some type of meaningful, organized set of knowledge. So that's what a chunk is. And we think about chunking as part of online course development. And then, just like Rativa talked about yesterday, how we're going to assess our students should match with what we're doing in the rest of the course. So what activities are they doing online? How do we have the course organized? What are the learning objectives, learning outcomes? And then what kinds of assessments of student learning are we going to use? A lot of these are look familiar to you, but there can also be different kinds of assessments online that instructional designers can work with the faculty members to do. So for example, it could be an electronic simulation, where the students would get in and use some sort of electronic simulation and get feedback from the software itself. And then that can be a process that can be done as part of an online course. It could be using different types of online activities. There's a number of handouts over there with lots of ideas. You can send your students on a web quest where they have to go out and they have to research something and compile some information. So an online format allows you to do something other than the traditional things that we might think about, tests, quizzes, all of that. You can think of different and novel activities that would fit. There's actually a very good book by Kurt Bonk that has 100 different online activities that can all be used depending upon the kind of course you're teaching. So the instructional designer plays a key role here in helping somebody think through what it is that they want to do in an online course. Then, this module planner that you see on the next page, this is a Microsoft Word document, and how this works is that for every single module, once they've decided how they're going to chunk content, they know their learning outcomes, they know how they're going to assess their student, then the real work begins of actually building the course. And for every single module, there will be a many-page document that will describe each objective and then answer these questions around each of the various objectives. So for objective number one, what is it? How are you going to assess the student learning? How are you going to deliver the content? What is the content? And how are you going to assess, and what kinds of learning activities are you going to structure? So how this typically has worked well for us is that there's a calendar. And so maybe every 2 weeks, a module is due. Or if there's 15 modules, one every week. And so, and the instructional designer is the person who coordinates all this, who reviews content, who keeps track of the faculty member, who says, how's module one coming? I'm looking for module one, and to give feedback to the faculty member. So it's a very time-intensive process, but it's all written out, and it's sort of agreed to. Here's what I'm going to do. It's a map that gets you to where you want to be in designing a course and all of the things that have to be factored in as you think through that whole process. And so they very much take seriously the idea that you have to, it's an iterative process, that you start this and then you begin the process and then you go back and you evaluate and say, what do I need to change? And ultimately with the goal to produce a high quality course. One of the things that Terry talked about,
I said on the presentation they talked about learning outcomes. Here it says learning objectives. Is there any difference? Are there any differences between learning objectives and learning outcomes?
We were just talking about that. In my view, they're the same. But the example that we looked at was very close. Mm-hmm. That there was a course objective and a learning outcome, and it was essentially just a slight wording change to make it into a learning outcome.
Because sometimes they use both of them. I think in Bologna,
process
they ask for both of them.
Yes, they do. And that's what we were looking at as an example.
What, how, what's the definition of that?
So at least the way the Bologna process is defining it, with the syllabus that we saw, it's written, objective is written, so, say something
passage.
Will be introduced, so
yeah.
That's more teacher-centered. And then the learning outcome is the student will learn.
Yeah.
But it's exactly the same thing that will be introduced, then the student will learn that, you know.
I remember in the outcomes you have to use active words, like students will be able to write, read,
right.
And not understand words. The understand is passive. So
those
are the rules for ABET.
But course objectives have to, in my mind, often follow the same format. But usually a learning outcome is course objectives. There's usually not, you know, a large number.
But if I can define it right, maybe it's one is teacher centered.
Yeah,
the other
is
one is student centered.
It would be good to get some actual definitions. Yes.
Yeah. I'd like to add one.
Okay.
You are right, because learning objective based on any, you know, design model,
yes.
We are going to create the objectives, but learning outcome is related to, you know, output,
mm-hmm.
and based on the learning objectives, and that means like output,
yeah.
And what we learn, what we got,
mm-hmm.
based on the objectives,
yeah.
And of course,
yeah.
Also product.
Yeah.
I think what my understanding is, if you have, for example, the moves like playing a dart, you know, you have one objective there, just to hit from the, you know, the bullseye.
Right.
But you also know that, probabilistically, you might be hitting other parts
mm-hmm.
too.
Mm-hmm.
I think outcomes is also summarizing the other stuff that might happen. But objective is very crystal clear, you know, this is this. That's real. Aiming, this is our target, but we might also come up with all these stuff too, you know.
Yeah.
And bad stuff. That's my understanding. Maybe.
I'm not
so
curious.
You come up with a portfolio of the outcomes, but a couple of objectives.
Right.
Yeah.
I think some clarity would be really helpful, Hassan, because I think some faculty are not quite sure how to proceed with that.
Yeah.
One of the things that, and I'm gonna give this Adobe presenter. I'm not gonna play it again. I'm gonna go to the. There was a question about how do you know if you create.
Welcome to the introduction to online course design presentation prepared.
Checklist, and it gets very specific. So for example, what should go into a course overview in an online course? And it literally gives you all of these things, and as faculty are developing these things, remember, faculty don't know how to do this, so the support around this is important, and the structure is extremely important. So it includes instructor information that creates a sense of connection between the instructor and the student. So that's where a lot of faculty will do things like introduce themselves, tell you about their favorite dog, or something about themselves that's interesting, like they might do in that situation. Incorporates an appropriate student orientation to online learning. So assuming that students do not necessarily know how to be online learners, what does it take to be good in an online learning if you're the student in this class? And so it literally goes through and it has checklists of every component that has that's part of this process. And you might think that's excruciating detail, but it's remarkable how helpful this is to people who are looking at blank sheets of paper and say, I don't know what to do. And so this gives them kind of a roadmap, if you will. And I won't go through all of these, I just want to give you the example. So a syllabus, we've talked some about syllabi and what ought to be there. This is literally a checklist of all the things that should go into a syllabus. This is relevant to our institution, different types of policies that we might have, and some references to what to do about. So in the syllabus should be what to do if you have a technical problem, how to handle it. Now the good news is that some of this is standard language that we already have developed for people. They can just grab that text and drop it in. So some of this can be reused many times over. So a lot of the things you see here, this is a very long list, you'll see, of things that need to go into a syllabus. And then recommended information that should go into a syllabus. Learning outcomes and detail about that. Learning activities. And so it goes. And then it gets into all of the different strategies, and it's got a check mark. It doesn't mean you have to do everything, but it's a very good, useful tool to kind of have next to you as you're working through these. And a question came up earlier about how do you know if it's a good online course? This checklist was developed with the research in mind about what it takes to develop a good course. So it's very detailed, but it can be extremely helpful. And you'll see it goes on for several pages around different aspects of the course. And sometimes what will happen is that the faculty member will need some help from the instructional designer who can sort of talk them through and say, have you considered this? What about that? You need to be thinking about this. So all of these tools are there, and they're hyperlinked from this Adobe Presenter file. So I think I can just send you this file, in which case you can get to the course planner, which is linked from this particular document, and also the course planner, which by the way goes on the back page, and I invite you to do that. And so you can get to all of these documents from this particular file, which is nice. So the point of all this is that there's a lot to think about as you prepare to teach a good online course, and the care it takes to be able to get to a place where it's of very high quality and does all of the things that we hope it will do. So with that, we've got about 20 minutes. Any questions, Katina?
I just had a comment. So taking things that exist online, if you take materials that exist online, one of the things that we are very careful, and I don't know what the laws are over here, but the copyright laws, you need to think about that. And there's an easy way to get around it, because you can contact the publisher or the author, and they'll give you permission. Or you have to, or the university might have to pay a little bit to get that permission. So sometimes people are very sensitive about posting PDF files if it's copyrighted. So always when you grab something from the internet, check it, because especially in online, it becomes public again. And I don't know how sensitive people are. This is something very local that you need to think about. But if you're getting international sources, then you might have to check with the author anyway, regardless of what the culture is here. That's something to, so you can get the librarian to help you with that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And what Fertina's talking about are copywriting materials.
Mm-hmm.
There's an awful lot of open source material out there that only
yeah.
requires a Creative Commons
yeah.
license. And so Connections is a very good example of this. It's a site that's out of Rice University. Everything that's in Connections is available for you to reuse. You can modify it. All you have to do is give credit to the person who wrote it. But you can change it, you can grab parts of it, you can rewrite it. If you want to, you can do whatever you want. You just have to reference that you got this from Connections and give credit to the person who...
Yes, what are some of those, can you give us some...
Yes, so here's, this is actually quite
science.
Nice. So there's lots of subjects here. You can browse, you can search this. Now, Connections is not fully populated in every domain. It comes out of a university that has a strong engineering background, so there's a lot more engineering content than, say, education, for example. But what's really interesting is that people will put things in Connections, and people will go get it, translate it, and there's a nice story about a person who wrote, I think it was some type of music theory book, and posted it to Connections, and it's been translated in like 26 languages, and is one of the largest downloads from Connections itself. If you're thinking about promotion and tenure, this is an interesting thing for you. If you have things that you've developed that you want to share with the world, what you can do is you can put them in Connections, and then Connections tracks how many downloads of those materials from everywhere in the world. So if 100,000 people downloaded your particular piece that you had written, this is pretty compelling. Some people wanted it, and they'll give you credit, and they'll cite you as the author of that particular.
So there are probably a lot more sites like this. Do you have a list of
Merlot? The two that are the most common are this one and Merlot, which is written like the word.
It's wine.
Wine. So this one. So for example, if I wanted to find something in psychology,
Merlot.org or Merlot.com.
This is it's Merlot.org. Yes.
Could you spell that Merlot?
It's Merlot.
Like wine.
Like the wine.
Yeah. Everyone knows that. Did you notice that?
Yes. Yeah. And Connections is cnx.org. And Connections is spelled with an X in this case. So here's an introduction to psychology, chapter one. And if I was teaching a psychology course and I didn't want my students to have to buy a textbook, and I liked what this particular material was about, I can download it as a PDF, as an EPUB. I can give feedback to the author on what I thought of the piece. I can add it to my favorites, and I can reuse or edit it. And then if I reuse it or edit it, what do? And you'll see that there's a CC BY, Creative Commons BY license there. That means you simply have to cite that this came from the author at Connections, and they actually tell you how to do that. So if you want to reuse the content, so you like some of what they did, and you sort of think, I could improve on that, you can do that. And in this case, it meets the CC BY 3.0 requirements. So in this case, it tells you exactly what you have to say, the author's name, the title of the work, and where you found it in Connections. And you have to just do that. That's it. It's yours to use.
So is this CC BY some kind of a law?
It's a Creative Commons license. Okay. So Creative Commons licenses are largely for open source. Do you want me to link them?
So no. So it requires basically the author's name, the title of the work.
And where it was found on the web. So that's pretty standard, that we would, put that kind of information in. But what's nice about this is that you can, in fact, then just take it and change it. And use what you want, and make it your own. And that's what's really powerful about this. So think about this as a community where we're all contributing knowledge, and we're all potentially improving on what others have done. And it's all done open source. So we don't have to give all of our money to the publishers who block this content under a copyright law that really does get us into trouble. So I personally would love the day when the publishers don't get all the money, and we as university faculty own this content, and we care about this content, and we contribute to the content, and we make sure that it's right and it's what it should be. And it's about doing that for our students and having the best information that we can out there available for everyone, for the common good, for everyone to benefit from. And so I would very much like to see that. You want to go to Merlot?
MIT also has a site.
Open courseware.
Open courseware.
And that's a whole course.
There is a project in Turkey where they are now translating all those courses to Turkish.
Yep.
So I think we have a faculty member who's in love with that for our software engineering.
And so that's something to think about. about how much is already out there. Now, that said, I teach educational psychology, and I tried to use only open source content, and there wasn't enough good open source content out there for me. So I used an electronic version of the textbook, which is still cheaper, but it's copyrighted. So I have to preserve the copyright there. I can't just go and change it and do whatever I want with it. But I could if I took it from a different site.
They have many disciplines, right?
Right. So here's a case where we could go into, and you'll see these are pretty similar to what you'd see in Connections. So they're both places to look. So,
is this English one which looks interesting? Our English department.
So we were looking for a supply and demand. On the break, we were looking for a supply and demand activity. Oops.
That sounds good. Elephant.
So there's Merlot's been around a long time, and there's some good content in here. I didn't find it. So there's not, it's not everything you'd ever want. So, but it's a place to look, especially when you're developing an online course and you need a nice explanation of something. Why do you have to write that? If somebody a leader in the field wrote it and made it available open source.
Actually,
go get it.
Wikipedia is like that too.
Yeah.
I copy a lot from that.
Yep.
My courses. Because they explain things in scientific detail quite a bit too.
And it's interesting, Hassan, when I mentioned this to faculty about, well, you should take really good things that you've done and put them in Merlot or put them in Connections, mm-hmm. and they'll say, well, no, it's my intellectual property. And I have to guard it. And I think what's going to happen is that notion of this is my intellectual property and I have to guard it will gradually erode. But it will take things like promotion and tenure guidelines changing for us to be fully realizing this. Because right now, assistant professors who are trying to get tenure, their ideas are important because they will help them earn tenure, at least in the United States. This is an area where they are protecting their intellectual property because it could earn them tenure. But if you think about what that really means for the greater good, that model doesn't quite work anymore because it means that it's all about that person. And it would be much better, in my view, this is my opinion, and others may disagree with me, but it would be much better if we all thought of ourselves as a community of scholars who are all working together. We can still track contribution. You can still say, this is the part that I contributed, and this is really key, and this actually changed it in a way that made it better, and it can be based on our own research. And so journals are one way to do that, but there's other ways to make these journals, this content available to the world in an open source arena. Okay, I'll get off the soapbox now. But this is pretty important, I think.
You mentioned actually promotion and tenure. Mm-hmm. There is no tenure system in this.
So just promotion?
So it doesn't need anything here, tenure, yeah. But maybe you can say in terms of basically renewing the contract. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yes, or something like that.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And that's important for them.
But the fact that, you know, that MIT did it and made all of their courses available, some faculty will still say, and they've said this to me at IP Live, yeah, but we're not MIT.
Mm-hmm.
And okay, so yes.
There was a project like that at Indiana University, open source project I thought was initiated, but it didn't.
Well, it's part of our strategic plan.
Yeah.
We're trying to do that.
It's
been hard to get faculty to want to do it. So I think what's going to happen is the faculty, some leaders, will end up just starting to put their stuff out there. We're members of the Connections Consortium.
That's what
consortium.
You need, leaders, yeah.
Yeah.
Leaders.
Get them to just do it. I do not anticipate what MIT did, which is a mandate from the top that everybody will put their stuff open to the world. I don't anticipate that.
Should we do that in Tatula University too? Would you recommend?
I think that's a decision for your faculty and you to decide.
Yeah.
think the way I would, I look at this is, there is some parts of knowledge and information that you can actually get from other places, and then there are things that you have to adapt it to your local realities.
Yeah.
For example, like the business book that we're studying, it's American written, and the examples the students can't relate with. They don't know Walmart. They don't. They. I mean,
yes.
Walmart is a big case. But it doesn't mean anything to them when the book gives an example on Walmart.
Uh-huh.
So I have to talk about Migros, Carrefour, all the others that correspond to at least retail sales and all that. So that means, as a matter of fact, if I put my stuff in the internet, it's just going to be of good use, because basically I'm simply taking something and adapting it, and there's a big demand for it, because the Turkish textbooks, they don't have any examples. I mean, not to the extent that the American textbooks have. Yes, they do have examples, but you got to update them all the time, especially in business. It's so current. So basically, I think it would help.
It would make a major contribution to do those kinds of things. And the data are then there, and you can see, you could, if you did this and you put it out there and 100,000 people downloaded what you did, that tells you something. It's really important. It's good for you, and it's good for the university, and it's good for the world.
You will get a promotion.
Yes, yes. So there's some real value to that, versus that you published it in a copyrighted, obscure journal that only people like us might read.
The problem with that is, in business, it changes so quickly, you can't publish it.
Right.
By the time you publish it, it's
out of date. That's
yes.
right.
But whereas
right.
this
here you
is
can
constant.
Publish very quickly.
Right,
exactly.
That's the value added to it.
Yeah.
You know, in Moodle also you can, for instance, you have option of making that information available to the entire world, or you make it available to your students only, or to the university community. So you have all those options too.
And this also has a Creative Commons license attached to it, so, which is very common. And we take this seriously at IU, and so the work that we do in the centers, the work that we do to support our open source learning management system, Sakai, it's all available, it's all free, and we give it away to anybody who wants it. They can take it, modify it, use it for their own institutions, because if you're gonna do this and you're gonna take this seriously, That's our commitment to doing that. So, any closing remarks, Hassan?
Yeah, before making any close remarks, you were going to use me as an example of a bad teacher.
That's Thursday.
Thursday?
Yeah, you can be a good teacher for the next 2 days. Next
okay.
day and
Thursday,
half.
Thursday, yeah. I won't come on Thursday.
Do you want to...
I'll be the ultimate bad.
Do you want to
talk about
preview... Tomorrow is that,
yes,
and
okay.
then the remaining days.
Yes, tomorrow's session is, we thought it was designed for administrators, like administrators in the sense that how to establish like a teaching and learning center, and also give them advice on what kind of maybe reward systems for people working in this area can be established, and also what kind of services can be provided. So you're welcome to attend this too, so it's open to everybody, but I'm particularly inviting administrators to come and listen to some of these, and I'm hoping that you will also summarize some of the things that we talk about till now, maybe just given brief overview of the topics that were discussed up until now, and maybe the ones which will be discussed on Thursday as well, because this will be our chance to influence their thinking as well, especially like deans and then president and then vice presidents and then department chairs too. On Thursday, though, there will be two interesting sessions. One is titled "Increasing Student Motivation and Engagement in the Classroom." This is actually, as far as I'm concerned, is extremely important for us. I think we all suffer from the lack of motivation of our students. So yeah, I think these would be interesting. Yeah, the next one is models for student-assisted teaching. Dr. Varma Nelson is very experienced in this area. I think she has a textbook or a book written in this area on for student-assisted teaching. Sometimes we call it student teaching, student or peer-led teaching. So for this, actually, she's suggesting if you can bring some student leaders that you can think of who might be interested to participate in a program like this, so that we can use them also in helping or establishing a program like that, maybe a small program like that here. So I'm going to make that announcement to the rest of the faculty too. But I think you're thinking in terms of some students maybe who are who have good grades and
good grades,
who are interested.
Good communication skills, you know. They always stand out, right? You always have students who have good communication skills.
A model student, yeah.
Who work well with their peers. You don't want a student who just keeps everything to himself, you know, or herself.
Generous student.
Yeah, willing to talk to others and working with others.
Yeah, that's what they are saying, that if the Thursday afternoon session,
right,
especially.
You can bring them. Then what I say, you can look at, get reaction from them too.
Yeah.
And they might say, okay, this won't work with our group, but some we can change it and it'll work better this way.
We may have to adapt it to our culture,
right,
but maybe this is something we can have a pilot study on that too. So if you also ask your friends or colleagues and mention that to them in your department, that would be good. But I'll make an announcement for that too. The Fridays also is basically, they are also interesting sessions, of course. Basically, this is related to student evaluation also, and plus getting feedback on your teaching. I think one method was getting feedback during the semester, mid-semester feedback, but there are other ways of getting feedbacks, and I think it was also mentioned, like focus groups, etc. I don't know if this will last 20, is there enough material for this for 2.5 hours?
I probably not.
Getting feedback on your teaching, maybe you want to teach some other things too.
Is that the last session?
That's
Friday morning.
You know what you might want to do is look at models, how do you do peer evaluation over here?
Yeah,
do
actually,
you have professors coming to your classes and evaluating your courses? Yeah, so how do you do it? I mean, that
we have that?
I think
do we
you
have
can.
That?
No, we
have.
No,
we
no.
don't.
So that might be something, how will it work?
Oh, so there is also, you're going to do peer review, yeah. Also, you don't
peer
get
review.
Only feedback from students, but
no,
you get your feedback
review.
From your, oh, I see, okay, so this means.
Can you talk about your model?
Also, all right, yeah. Okay, yeah, this is interesting.
Yeah.
We may want to adopt something like this here too, again, instead of students helping students, it will be faculty helping faculty,
right,
kind of a model, okay, to improve our teaching, the quality of our teaching. And then Friday afternoon, you know, there are a lot of issues, of course, related to teaching. Many universities, the emphasis is on, of course, on research, which is at our university too. But that doesn't mean that you're going to neglect teaching and learning, and but then there has to be some reward systems on that, and I think our guests are going to talk about a little bit about some good models at other universities, and then we're going to provide some feedback to them what it is at our university. At our university, research comes first, but then we have a lot of faculty who like to do teaching, and we want to reward that faculty too, but we don't right now know how to basically set up this. But we may want to talk about what some of the applications are in other universities in the U.S. In the U.S. also, in many universities, research is the priority.
Absolutely.
But then you cannot neglect teaching either. So there is a reward system in. Some universities, like many universities, if a person is
excellent in teaching, he she or he can also get promoted. In other words, become from assistant professor, they can move to associate professor just for being excellent in teaching. Okay, that does not really exist here quite because we still ask them to publish so many papers, and without that they cannot get promoted. But I think that has to change a little bit, somewhat too, because it, at least universities like ours. And then, but to do that, to get that kind of a promotion, as the documentation of teaching is extremely important. How do you document that? You know, the excellent teacher doesn't mean that that teacher has very good student evaluation. That's not enough. Okay, you have to a lot more things. And you can also do research in teaching too, mm-hmm. teaching methods. You don't have to have an education degree to do research.
It helps to partner with people in education.
Yeah, it probably helps, but you don't have to have only that. So today I'm going to talk about some mm-hmm. of those. And I think they'll be happy to discuss or talk about other topics too. So if you have other topics in mind for them to talk about, please let them know, or let me know. If you send me an email, mm-hmm. also I will ask them to come up with some discussing some.
I was also thinking of the Friday afternoon session, which is a wrap-up session. It's a good thing to spend some time having a conversation about all these things you've listened to all week long. What is it that you're going to take away from it? What can you do in your classes, you know? And if you wanted to do it tomorrow, what would you need to do? So sort of an action plan for yourself. Is what do I need to do? How will I do it? What do I do? And really, I'm looking at this session as a conversation between faculty and your leader, Hassan Hoja. To really think about what makes sense on this campus in this culture. Mm-hmm. You know, really, I don't think there is one model that can be transported. It needs to be something that you own. And same thing with the discussion tomorrow morning. You know, if you build a center that faculty had an input in, then you will use it. There are centers that are used a lot, then there are centers that don't get used a lot. But the key is, if the faculty had a hand in designing it, mm-hmm. then there's ownership.
More, yeah.
So this is a good time, I think exciting, because he's talking about building a center. It's an exciting time to talk about what you want it to look like, you know.
And we will also give a reception for these ladies. Either I'm debating whether that should be on Thursday afternoon or Friday afternoon. What do you think? What could be better? We're going to give a nice reception Thursday?
Friday.
Thursday?
Because we have a
flight
on Saturday morning.
It's not going to be there. It's not the morning.
We'll be that late.
Too,
yeah.
Okay.
What would you prefer?
You can answer.